In 2003, the United States military unleashed a campaign the press had pre-christened Shock and Awe, the dominant and overwhelming application of American military power against Saddam Hussein's Iraq and its military. Within weeks, U.S. forces controlled all of Iraq, and then the fighting really began. Today's guest unravels the decision-making that led to what he calls America's greatest foreign policy tragedy. He's Michael J. Mazarr this week on Story in the Public Square. And welcome to Story in the Public Square, where storytelling meets public affairs. I'm Jim Lutis from the Pell Center at Salve Regina University. Alongside me is my friend and co-host G. Wayne Miller of the Providence Journal. Story in the Public Square is an effort to study, celebrate, and tell stories that matter. To do that, we sit down every week with the best storytellers around, filmmakers, authors, journalists, and scholars, to make sense of the big stories that shape public life in the United States today. To help us this week, we're joined by Michael J. Mazarr, a senior political scientist at the RAND Corporation and author of a new book about America's march to war in Iraq, Leap of Faith, Hubris, Negligence, and America's Greatest Foreign Policy Tragedy. Mike, thank you so much for being with us.
Great to be here.
So the book is terrific. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What led you to write it?
At the time that the war started, I was working at the National War College in D.C., a school for senior military officers and State Department officials and others, and we started to get folks coming back from the war, telling stories about how it had been begun with really not much planning and amazing chaos in the aftermath. And that sparked an initial question of how could this happen? And then, of course, as the aftermath unfolded, becomes another classic tragedy in American foreign policy. And so having worked with a lot of the folks that waged the war sparked my initial interest.
So would you say that it had happened with a lot of planning? I mean, we think of the Department of Defense as just sort of, you know, miles and miles of file cabinets full of different war plans.
Yeah.
Plan Z, right? What do you mean there wasn't a lot of planning?
Well, primarily for the post-war. I mean, they planned the actual sort of conquest of Iraq and the move to Baghdad and all that with unbelievable efficiency. And it's really not a matter of the fault of the planners or the Defense Department per se. The larger government, the NSC, civilians in the Defense Department, we were not just going to win a war. We were not just going to conquer an army. We were going to occupy a country. We were going to take possession of this country of 25 million people. And the ideas that they had of how that would be done were very poorly worked out. And there had also been debates among different senior officials about what that would look like that were never resolved right up to the end.
So who was involved in these discussions that you're talking about right now? What individuals or what divisions or branches of the military and also of the U.S. government?
So the whole U.S. government's involved to some extent in this. Eventually, the Defense Department, in January of 2003, the president issues a presidential order giving the Defense Department control of the post-war. And Don Rumsfeld had lobbied for that. He'd advocated for it, partly because of what he saw go on in Afghanistan, where he was very frustrated that the CIA had the initial lead on that. The problem is that in taking control of it, the Defense Department then proceeded in many ways to shut out other actors throughout government, not take their advice, not absorb some of the planning that had been going on for over a year in other places in government. So it was this sort of dilemma or contradiction that a lot of people were thinking about it in some way, but it was not clearly coordinated. And the one department that was ultimately responsible for it was headed by a guy, Don Rumsfeld, who was committed to the idea that the United States was not going to occupy Iraq. It was going to get in and get out quickly. So he didn't treat it seriously.
I mean, it sounds like a mess. I mean, this is not how you plan a war in its aftermath.
Well, that's one of the real paradoxes of this is that, I mean, this was a group not only at that level of Rumsfeld, Cheney, Rice, Powell, but also throughout the government of some of the most experienced national security people you can imagine. I mean, even folks like Scooter Libby is a guy with decades of experience running policy. So it does lead to this odd question of how could people that experienced and that smart have produced an operation that was so half-hearted and incompetent, really.
Well, and so I'm struck, I wanted to ask you about the leap of faith part of your title, but I'm thinking about the subtitle,
Right.
Hubris, negligence. I mean, is that what we're talking about here? Was this excessive pride that?
Well, I think there's pride involved. Yeah, there's a sense of the negligence piece comes in. One of the folks I interviewed, all my interviews were anonymous, but one of them was a senior person working in the White House who was furious at what was going on in Rumsfeld's Pentagon and described it as criminal negligence. And I hadn't really thought about that concept before, but then doing a little research into the legal concept of negligence and what the characteristics are. And I mean, basically the senior folks, particularly Rumsfeld and others in the Defense Department that ran this war, met every test of what you would think of as a legal standard of negligence.
Well, let me ask you this question. So the national security community is legendary for its ability to plan and process things.
Yeah.
Is this really just the function of Rumsfeld running the ship and saying we're not gonna do that planning because we don't want to do that mission?
So it's a combination of things. So within the military, even in the military plans, they have the part of it that's called phase four, which is the post-war period. And any good military planning shop will do a phase four plan. And they did some degree of that, but they were consumed with planning for the rest of the war and just didn't have the resources left over. Now, partly that is because the person in charge of the planning, Tommy Franks, the head of Central Command, made it clear to his staff that once they got there and conquered the country, the rest of it was somebody else's problem, which I think in retrospect is not a very wise decision. At the same time, you had a concern in the government, very strange in retrospect, that if they started post-war planning too early, they would tip their hand to the world that they really intended to go to war, even though they were saying they weren't sure yet. And in retrospect, you ask people and say, well, you were planning for the war very publicly. How in the world would more post-war planning have somehow undermined your credibility? And there's no good answer to that. So it was a combination of confusion and just insufficient attention to this problem.
One other thing I want to follow up on this here, though. So I have a really distinct memory of the lead up to the war. I had just started working up on Capitol Hill, and I remember attending a committee hearing. I think it was an Armed Services Committee hearing, where the question was, how many forces are we going to need to occupy Iraq after the war? And they had a couple of folks in uniform and a couple of folks from different think tanks, and the numbers, just to my historian's ear, seemed absurdly low. Yeah. Based on what we knew about previous historical occupations of entire countries.
Yeah.
Was that wishful thinking? Were they selling a narrative? Was it?
So one of the factors that I sort of talk about as being an engine of this kind of tragedy, which is not unique to the Iraq case, is that the advocates have some kind of a scheme, some kind of a notion that here's how we can fight this war on the cheap. I've got this plan. This is how it's going to work. And you see that repeatedly. I mean, in the Bay of Pigs, we had the plan that we were just going to put some Cubans ashore, right? And we wouldn't have to
invade. Revolution would follow, right.
So in this case, the scheme was, we're going to go into Iraq, find some Iraqis, put them in charge, and leave. And the Iraqi oil revenues are going to pay for their reconstruction, and we won't have to have anything to do with it. They were empowered in that scheme by the experience they just had in Afghanistan, when that's exactly what they did. They found Hamid Karzai, they put him in charge, and it seemed in 2002 that that was working out okay. In retrospect, not so much. So they had that idea that allowed them to convince themselves that we wouldn't need that. Now, having said that, to your point, every expert in post-war planning, in post-war security situations, who seriously looked at this problem, came up with similar numbers in the range of 300,000 to 500,000 people.
Right.
And one infamous example is when Rumsfeld was talking to Jay Garner, the retired general was going to go over and take over the initial operation of the post-war. And Garner was telling him some of the funding they needed for some of their activities. He said, Don, we're going to need about $1 billion for this. And Rumsfeld looked at him and said, Jay, if you think we're spending $1 billion of the American taxpayers' money in Iraq, you're sorely mistaken.
Well, and so 300 to 500,000 were those estimates, but I think that the number that of American forces that were in Iraq in the immediate aftermath of the war was around 120,000?
Yes, and partly because the initial war plan, we now know, had over 300,000, and Rumsfeld constantly had this vision of transformation in warfare and was constantly cutting the numbers down. This is actually another reason why the post-war planning doesn't get done, is because the staffs are spending so much time responding to Rumsfeld's micromanagement of the numbers that they don't have time.
So this planning and this execution wasn't happening in a vacuum. This wasn't a bunch of people in a bar saying, we ought to do this, maybe we won't, can we have another round? There was a commander-in-chief. There was a president. Where was the president?
So, George,
you know, the Harry Truman line, the buck stops here, comes to mind. Where was he during this?
So Bush is, of course, a fascinating figure. I actually ended this research in talking to, for example, dozens of people that worked with him on a daily basis, with a significant amount of sympathy for Bush and feeling that he is essentially a pretty authentic person who is trying to do what he thought was the best. There's a lot of stuff that's been written about in terms of the role of his born-again Christian faith in convincing himself that 9/11 had come, delivered a moment that God had sort of put him in place to help the nation deal with, and his, you know, famous inattention to detail and impatience, all that contributed to the problem. But there's a related issue which is not unique to him, which is that presidents are not responsible for the details of planning. They aren't, and to the extent that they try to get involved, it usually doesn't go well. They have to count on their subordinates. So as an example, when one of my now RAND colleagues, Jim Dobbins, one of these experts in post-war planning, took a RAND study saying they would need 500,000 people to Paul Bremer just before he went over to take over Iraq, Bremer took that to Bush and said, I think we're about to have a problem because these experts say this. Bush says, okay, I'll look into it. And he comes back and says, I asked Don Rumsfeld, and he says, we've got enough. And I can't really blame a president once the commander, General Franks, and the SecDef have said this is the military reality. It takes an awful lot for a president to override that.
But there's another party that was at least observing this, and that was Congress. Where was Congress during this whole period?
So,
I mean, certainly the average person knew at some point here, things are really going off the rails, folks. I mean, come on, we don't have to have, you know, an advanced degree to know that. Congress?
And so that's a great question. And where was the media, I have to say? That's another good question.
Another really good question, because they, yes.
And in terms of the timing of your question, lots of people inside the government knew that this was going to go off the rails a month before we actually went into Iraq. One great example is at the National Defense University, where I was
really
working.
Really, a month before?
They had a planning meeting in February of 2003, where they got people from all over, run by Jay Garner, to say, here's what we're all going to... They had all these PowerPoint presentations, and everybody I talked to who walked away from that said, this is going to be a disaster. We don't know what we're doing. We don't have the resources. No one is coordinated. It's a complete disaster waiting to happen.
That's startling to hear.
Members of Congress and the media could and should have known a lot more about the details of planning, the rationale for the war, but also how it was being designed. And one of the things I argue in the book is that this is a failure not only of the administration, but also of the larger public policy environment of the United States, including the Congress and the media.
Explain that a little bit more, if you could.
So, you were working on the Hill. So yeah. It would not, I mean, one fact that has been widely reported is the small number of members of Congress that actually read the full National Intelligence Estimate. That's a problem.
Right.
But even beyond that, for members of Congress that have spent a lifetime working on national security officials, it's not out of the realm of possibility to send a senior defense aide to go talk to people at State, the NSC, the Pentagon,
right,
and get some sensing of, this seems like an odd thing to do. Did they really have their act together? In the case of the media, I mean, you had a couple of folks, James Fallows being one of the few exceptions, who did a major piece interviewing a lot of post-war reconstruction experts and sort of predicting how this was likely to go. You had a handful of other people really trying to poke holes in not just the rationale, not just the WMD piece, but are we really ready to do this? What are we going to do when we get there? Those questions were hardly asked by anybody.
Is some of that, you think, though, a function of, so remember the first Persian Gulf War in the early 90s, sort of this triumphant moment in American respect for the military, sort of the ghosts of Vietnam were killed, I think, is the way the first President Bush put it.
Mm-hmm.
And the American public's adulation for the American military has been astronomically off the charts. Every other institution in American society has looked upon poorly, but not the U.S. military.
Yeah.
Was there too much confidence in the thought that these are pros, they are the best in the world, they're going to do it right?
So I suspect that's part of it. Another enormous part, of course, is the post 9/11 mindset, which it's hard to put ourselves back in that mindset now. But I mean, just as an indication of how the country was had sort of a bloodlust after 9/11, the vote to approve the Iraq War in 2003 passed by a larger margin than the vote to approve the Iraq War in 1990-91. So the country was behind this, and I think that's true. But for anybody who is a even modest professional in the national security realm, members of Congress, staff, defense media folks, they know that there is a big difference between fighting the operational war and doing the post-war, doing the aftermath. If you're going to occupy a country, it's a whole different thing. So for them, I think, for the folks that really should have been looking into this, they ought to have been able to differentiate that and say, I totally trust the military to win the war itself. Yeah. It's what's after comes after that I'm worried about.
So did any of the principals involved in this ever come out publicly and say, you know what, we screwed up big time, I'm sorry?
No, I think the closest, I mean, so two things before they would come out afterward. There was never a meeting in the Bush administration where all the principals gathered to actually discuss the question of whether we should go to war in Iraq.
Wait, say that one more time.
Yeah, I was just going to say. I don't think I heard it right either.
There was never what they call a principals meeting or an NSC meeting where the cabinet, national security cabinet members were actually brought together to discuss, we're thinking about doing this, is it a good idea? It was the idea sort of percolated to the surface. And there was a lot of discussion. I mean, you talk to the folks who are involved in the interagency process on this, and they all describe it the same way, as one of the oddest processes they were ever a part of, because no one was ever asking the main questions. Should we do it? How much will it cost? What are the main risks? The risk came out sort of accidentally. There was a little bit of that, but so there was sort of it was policy by osmosis and emergence rather than actual decision. Before the war, so Powell on August 5th, 2002, goes to Bush and says, okay.
Secretary of State Colin Powell.
And has this famous meeting where he asks Condi Rice to see the president and says, Mr. President, I gather you're thinking about doing this. I just want to be sure you understand what the possible consequences can be. And this is the meeting where he laid out the Pottery Barn rule, you know, you break it, you bought it, all that. But his from all the reporting we have, the tone was, you have to be aware of these risks, not, I don't think this is a good idea. Now, in Great Britain, two cabinet members actually resigned over Tony Blair's move toward war because they disagreed with it. In the United States, you didn't have any, and even those folks who were sort of at a second level, a great example being Ambassador Bill Burns, who's just published a very thoughtful book on this with one chapter on the Iraq piece. Even people who had severe concerns never really spoke up. They never really went to the president or to try to get a meeting together to say, this is a bad idea, we need to rethink this. That just never happened.
So I want to go back to the fact that there was not that meeting.
Yeah.
A family planning to go to Disney World has a meeting, do we want to go to Disney World and how are we going to do it, right? Kind of simple, basic
they might.
Human behavior.
Yes.
Why? I mean,
because
you sort of answered this in a lot of different ways, but this question directly, why was there not such a meeting?
For a number of reasons. The main reason is that there were a number of those in government that already, I think there's a lot of exaggerated reporting that the Bush administration was determined to get rid of Saddam as soon as it came in power. I think that's not necessarily true. Absent 9/11, I don't think there would have been an invasion per se. But there were people who had come to the decision that Saddam was a danger that could no longer be left in place. Once 9/11 happens, you get Cheney's famous 1% doctrine. Mm. Rumsfeld is equally committed to it. There's nobody who thinks it's a bad idea to get rid of him. And you've got a bunch of second-tier people in the bureaucracy who are absolutely committed that this is going to happen. So you end up getting what I sort of lay out in the book as a two-tier policy process where there are those who knew, and literally, we have notes from Rumsfeld's aide on the afternoon of 9/11. He says, you know, take out Saddam Hussein, threats connected and not, something like that. So he's thinking about it immediately, as is Cheney. So they've already made the decision. They don't need a decision meeting, and frankly, they don't want big debates about it. They just believe it should happen. Now, they believe it should happen for the best interest of the country, so we have to give them that. And then there is the official policy process, where there's a bunch of deputies meetings and principals meetings to talk about lots of individual little issues, but never to actually get them together and say, should we do this? Is it a good idea? Because implicitly, they had all come to that point.
There was, so we've spent a lot of time on this station, on this show, and just as a public over the last couple of years, talking about Russian influence campaigns in the 2016 election. There was a influence campaign around the America's March to War in Iraq, wasn't there?
Sure.
And it was the Iraqi National Congress and others.
So there is an inside and an outside. I mean, the Iraqi National Congress, headed by this Iraqi expatriate named Ahmed Chalabi, he had been working since the Clinton administration in various capacities. He was a CIA asset, a State Department asset, eventually a DOD asset. He was one of the people who was providing defectors with testimony that turned out to be wrong. He was very specifically asked afterward, are you sad about that? And he said, no, we're in Baghdad now. Why would I be sad that I gave them bad info?
Well, and the defectors that he kept putting forth would go to the New York Times and get front page coverage for biological labs under hospitals that...
Well, this is another great example of the role of the media, where they just, you know, were not giving that stuff enough. So there was also a group called the White House Iraq Group, which is the sort of public relations group in the White House communication shop, designed to make the case for war. Now, I don't find that tremendously conspiratorial, because when the United States considers going to war or is in a war, it has to make the case for that war.
Right.
That's what it does. And one of the interesting things of my research is that I ran across precisely nobody who said, I knew the intel was bad, but we still put it out there because we needed to convince the American people. Even skeptics of the war firmly believe that the WMD intel in particular and the general idea about Saddam's danger was valid, which helps to explain, I think, why they didn't speak out a little more strongly.
So one of my favorite moments on this show is always when we talk about craft. Talk about the craft here. You talk to a lot of people, a lot of people. How difficult was it to have them speak to you and reminisce about what happened?
There's a whole mixed bag, you know, very, very, partly depending on when I talked to them. I did interviews over a period of years, so the closer it was to the invasion, probably the more closed people were. It related to the degree to which they had become embittered about the war and were really willing and wanted to talk about what had happened to sort of not, you know, clear their conscience, but just to process what had happened and why, to help someone figure out why this could have happened. And there were some people that never answered multiple letters, that just didn't want to talk about it.
So where did you interview people? I mean, it was anonymous, so were some people concerned that, I don't know, you're carrying a wire? Or...
No, I think, you know, I mean...
Does he look like he would carry a wire?
I'm not going to answer that question.
Well, you know, hopefully I could have a little bit of that.
Either answer I give, I'm going to be in trouble, so...
That's right, exactly. So, no, I mean, you know, I think part of it helped that I was working at the National War College. I did all this research on my own time, but still... I was, you know, working in an academic environment, working in an environment where clearly my thought was connected to the sort of well-being of U.S. military personnel. So all of that, I think, probably helped. A handful of the folks I knew.
And you're being a little bit modest, because you're a well-established and well-regarded national security scholar. So I think people would take that invitation from you at face value as someone who's trying to do that kind of research.
I'm quite certain that a lot of these people had no idea who I was, but they were nice and sharing information.
Let's pull back just a little bit in the couple of minutes that we have left. The legacy of the war. Mm-hmm. What is the legacy of the war in Iraq?
So I'd say two things about that. One is kind of direct cost legacy, right? So one of the reasons I talk about it being one of the arguably the biggest American foreign policy tragedy, we know the direct cost in terms of 4,400 Americans gave the ultimate sacrifice, 32,000 were grievously wounded, hundreds of thousands have psychological damage. Now, the Iraqi casualties range from 150,000 to 500,000, depending on what estimates you take.
Just astounding, horrifying numbers.
The cost from $800 billion to $3 trillion, again, depending on what numbers you take. So those are things we can measure. Two things we can't measure that I think may be even more important. One is, I think that Iraq, combined with the later financial crisis, becomes one of the major additional blows to Americans' faith in their institutions. Yet another case of people telling you to trust me, we've got this, and it turns out not to be true. And I think
that's a really good point.
That has significant relationship to the polarization we're seeing today, although it may be submerged. The other is the international cost. So a whole variety of U.S. rivals and adversaries look at Iraq, North Korea, Russia, and others, and say, if America can do that, it can do anything. We think that America, and the language that surrounded it, remember, was we were on starting this global campaign against evil. So we know for a fact that North Korea accelerated its nuclear work as a result of this, that it became another reason why Vladimir Putin became convinced that he had to become more hostile toward the West. And years later, when the Ukraine crisis comes up, he sees in the American ambassador's role in Ukraine an echo of what he saw in Iraq, of American regime change operations. So in a lot of ways, we exacerbated international challenges that we now have to deal with.
It's do you 20 seconds left. Does the future of American foreign policy, you know, in the rest of the world, will it always be shaded by our experience in Iraq?
For a very long time, unquestionably, still is today.
It's a sober place to leave it. Mike Mazarr, the book is Leap of Faith, remarkable piece of work. Congratulations. That's all the time we have this week. But if you want to know more about Story in the Public Square, you can find us on Facebook and Twitter, or visit pellcenter.org, where you can always catch up on previous episodes. For G. Wayne Miller, I'm Jim Lutis, asking you to join us again next time for more Story in the Public Square.